I find many deserving cardiac patients, particularly the marginalized, poor women and children, are denied advanced cardiac treatment. And therefore, I thought of establishing a charitable organization known as Marian Cardiac Center and Research Foundation. And we have been able to also do many cardiac camps, not only in cities like Pune, but also in the rural areas. We went as far as Rahuri and Abruj in Solapur district, like that. So we went really to the rural areas where I found the rheumatic heart disease is still rampant. That is how we started this organization. And now Dr. Manoj has taken over the surgical program of our cardiac center, and it's doing well. In mid-1970s, to be exact, 76-77, I was, and also when I was in training at Vellore, I was involved with the pacemakers implantation. At that time, the permanent pacemaker or the battery is the heart of the pacemaker, used to be very large because of the weight. From that time onwards, there are a lot of refinement and probably research and development has taken place. Lithium power source, which I had the pleasure of implanting the first dozens or so in Pune in 1977 to 1980, to the extent that I traveled all the way to Melbourne, Royal Melbourne Hospital, Australia, to learn not only the advanced techniques of implanting the permanent pacemakers, and also I went through the first-hand training in electrophysiology. Now the pacemaker size has further come down. Very clear with you, the initial pacemaker which I implanted weighing about 300 grams, but now of course it has come down less than 100. And even the other day, Dr. Manoj has implanted a pacemaker in a 9 kilo child. And the weight of, or the size of the pacemaker, because of the refinement in the battery that is known as lithium power source, it's very, very small. And it's also, the circuitry also has improved, and it is quite safe for the patient.
I think it was exhilarating because it was a milestone in the history of medical profession in Pune that we could do the first heart transplant. Doing a heart transplant is not an easy venture, and it is not a one-man show. It is a huge team behind the whole effort. So it took us almost 2 years to plan, conceptualize the procedure, and then we got it done on the 5th of March 2017. Since then, we have witnessed around 23 heart transplants in Pune city, including a second center, which we have started recently. And that patient also got discharged within 2 weeks. So I'm very happy that I've contributed to developing 2 centers for heart transplant in the city of Pune. I think I would be proud of that, definitely. And I would also thank my team, who has been behind all this kind of, you know, crazy kind of concepts and doing all that stuff, what we need. Yeah. Coronary artery disease is primarily a lifestyle kind of, you know, disease. Mm-hmm. It's something what we call non-communicable disease. In the younger generation, we have found that erratic lifestyle, fast food, mm-hmm. and stress, alcohol, smoking, sedentary lifestyle has contributed a lot to the development of coronary artery disease becoming like an epidemic, in epidemic proportions. So I have seen patients who have had an angioplasty at 28, 29, which was never happening before, I'm sure, during my dad's time. But now it's becoming rampant. Also, so this is lifestyle related. The second thing which is very important, which I'd like to tell the doctor community here, is that it's also related to the socio-economic status and the diet. I go to Anand Rishi Hospital, which is a trust hospital in Ahmednagar. There must be at least 40 odd women I've operated who don't have BP, hypertension, don't have sugar, but they come from the lower socio-economic status, okay, and they're pure vegetarian. So I have a feeling there's a lot of inherent coronary artery disease in Indians related to the poor socioeconomic status and vegetarianism. Maybe related to the homocysteine levels, I don't know. But if you go to Gujarat, if you go to North Karnataka, you'll find rampant coronary artery disease among this subset of people. So if you ask me, I would say these are the two subsets which I can think of. It is a socioeconomic problem, a diet problem, a genetic problem, and a lifestyle problem.
Congenital heart disease has to be tackled when the child is very young. If you allow them to grow, they develop innumerable complications. A major complication, even a simple hole, what we call it a left to right shunt, which is eminently treatable, would lead to severe emergence of pulmonary hypertension, and the shunt will reverse and the child will become blue, what we call it Eisenmenger's syndrome. So we should not allow these children to go into this stage of inoperability. That is one. Number two is certain conditions like hypoplastic left heart syndrome, transposition of great vessels, unless they are tackled during the neonatal period, they will not be able to survive. With the modern techniques, we could do that. So, in other words, what I would emphasize is early diagnosis, early intervention, early referral to one of the advanced centers is very important to save these children.
The patients are obviously very happy that they come and they want to get some life-saving procedure done. Most of our children, the parents obviously are young, so they're starting off in their careers. They don't have much of money. And many of these people with congenital heart disease, their parents are very poor, right? When they come in front of me and say that, you know, they have this XYZ problem in the echo report, I know that this patient, as the professor said, need to be operated within a week or 2 weeks. If they start running around to different trusts, it'll be 6 months, because each trust gives 5,000, 10,000, 25,000. There are just a couple of trusts I can name who give like 3 lakhs or 2 lakhs. So what initiative we have done is we give the money in bulk. Like for example, there's a waiter's daughter from Ahmednagar. We sent her, at that time I didn't have a heart transplant license in Pune city. We sent her to Chennai with a check of 7 lakhs. And we told the surgeon there to get her operated, and they also raised money through their trust. But we need to give them that amount so that it can be done quickly. They cannot wait. So when these kids come, the parents come, they know that it's a one-stop solution. They can come here, get the job done. They don't have to move around quite a bit. And running around, I feel, can cost a life.
Yes.
So that's what my whole belief and our whole system is, that do it as a life-saving, urgent procedure and look at the socioeconomic status, obviously, and then get the job done. So I'm sure the parents and the children are happy that they've got their operation done quickly and without running around too much.
हेलो, मेरा नाम प्रेरणा रेंद्र संदानशिव. जैसे मैं आपको आज दिख रही हूँ, पहले वैसी नहीं थी. मुझको पहले ऐसे दम लगता था, सांस फूलती थी. एक हमारा मेरी बुआ के घर के पड़ोसी ने बताया, दुरायराज डॉक्टर नाम करके एक डॉक्टर है, तो उनके पास जाओ, आपका प्रॉब्लम सॉल्व हो सकता है. तो फिर हमने ये भी ट्राई करके देखा, चलो आखिरी कोशिश करके देखते हैं. तो फिर हम इस डॉक्टर के पास आए, तो डॉक्टर ने मुझे देखते ही मेरा केस हाथ में ले लिया. फिर आखिर में वो दिन आ ही गया, 2 अप्रैल 2017 को मेरा ऑपरेशन हुआ. और उस दिन से मैं एक महीने तक बेड रेस्ट पे थी और 10 दिन फिर मैं चलने फिरने लगी, फिर एक महीने बाद तो टोटली क्लियर हो गई।
Yeah, we don't have major donors, so I'll appeal to the doctor community also if they can reach out to any corporates who can also help us, because dad has got a lot of well-wishers among his old patients. He's been in practice for like, I don't know, since when, maybe 50 years?
50 years after the initial qualification, that is the MD.
Yeah.
But I am in private practice from 1984.
So he has got a lot of patients who have contributed to our trust. It's not that we are having huge infrastructure where we write for fundraising. So there are challenges in raising money. So we have maybe 30 or 35 odd donors who help us. We just call them and say, boss, we need the money. So they just send some money and we just get the job done. So it's an ad hoc thing at the moment. But these are the challenges which we are facing. Because if we have an infrastructure in place, it costs a lot to keep the infrastructure. I could have done maybe 10 operations in that cost. That is how I'm looking at it. So there are challenges, but then we just move on. We have to keep doing it.
Message I would like to convey to the doctors is, do not deny advanced, higher specialty treatment to anyone for want of funds. We could always get the job done by collecting funds through various people who are fond of helping others. So my message would be, don't deny advanced treatment to anyone who needs it, particularly the women, underprivileged and the children in our country. This would be my message.